Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are in the world today, and welcome to Movie Watch Live tonight. We are celebrating the 50th anniversary of Get Carter from 1971, the neo-noir cult classic crime thriller starring Michael Caine and written and directed by Mike Hodges, based on Ted Lewis's 1970 novel, Jack's Return Home. The film follows the archetypal anti-hero Jack Carter, played by Michael Caine in this instance, which is the only decent movie version of the story. We're not talking about the sequel. That didn't happen. In this movie, the central hero travels north to Newcastle for the funeral of his brother, who has died under suspicious circumstances. And thus, he delves into the seedy, foul underworld of the crime syndicates in Newcastle and discovers the real truth of what's happened. And so tonight I'm joined by Get Matt and Tony Caine Mutiny. Get Matt is Eric, the character from the movie tonight, and Tony is the disgruntled Caine from the sequel that we never talk about, or the remake we never talk about. Good evening, Matt. How are you doing tonight? And have you seen this movie before?
Yeah, doing all right. And like most of your movies, it's been on my list, and I've never seen it. So this will be fun.
Yeah. Have you seen any other Caine movies at all from around this era?
Yeah, I've seen, I think I've seen about three or four of his 60s movies now at this point. And then there's a big gap up until Batman, pretty much. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be neat to kind of bridge that a bit. The grittier 70s side of Caine. So
this is as dark as Caine got, or one of the darkest movies that he ever did. We've already got a comment from Elrod in the chat here. Any movie where Ian Hendry gets killed is great. That clip through Theatre Blood for a horrible one-liner makes me mad every time. But otherwise, we have also with us tonight Tony Caine Mutiny, who joins us from Australia. And he's basically eating his bacon and eggs over there this morning. good morning, Tony, I should say. And how are you doing? And have you seen this movie before?
Good morning. Oh, it's now it's just turned afternoon. So, I'm doing pretty well. And yes, I have seen it, but I haven't seen it for about 20 years.
Right.
It's been a while. But yeah, loved it. Really, really good, solid film. I went through a phase of just going through actors and watching movies of theirs that I hadn't seen, just to sort of expand my appreciation of their work. So yeah, that was during my Michael Caine phase, and
absolutely. I mean, this movie really it wasn't that well known for a long time, and then obviously with the advent of the internet, one of those, it's a typical example of the internet really grew. They've had a small cult following, but the internet really grew that exponentially, and it's considered today it's now one of the most well-known Caine movies, ironically, you know.
Oh, only after the fact.
Yeah,
exactly. And I think we're saying before the show that this movie, along with another movie, 1971, The French Connection, sort of relaunched the noir genre and sort of rebooted it and introduced like neo-noir and influenced a lot of other movies. I mean, Guy Ritchie, I mean, I think of something like Layer Cake. I mean, Layer Cake must have been influenced by this movie.
I'd agree with you, absolutely,
especially the ending. There's a host of other movies that which came in the late 70s and throughout the 80s and 90s, which definitely refer back to this movie. But I love this movie because it influenced what came after, but it was also influenced by what came before as well. It's in the tradition of noir, but to me, it's like two different movies. It's a noir, and then it's also a revenge movie at the same time. It's a phenomenal directorial debut for Mike Hodges. So yeah, an incredible movie. So we're looking forward to watching it. So I should say to everybody in the chat and everybody who's watching live and everybody who watched recorded that this is a commentary channel. We cannot show the movie or else the lady who owns YouTube will remove us quicker than you can, I don't know, throw a shrimp on the barbie, which never actually happens in Australia. That is a cliche that never actually happens. But of course, there's a lot of people who subscribed, and please subscribe. It's free. Doesn't cost you anything. Like and share. If you like commentary, if you like to listen to people talk about the movie and you want to watch along with us, a lot of people do, then join us. This is a show for you. Elrod says again in the chat, fun fact for the nude scene. And I have to warn people, if they haven't seen this movie before, there is plenty of, how should we say, Bristol cities in this movie. That's Cockney rhyme and slang, which Caine would be proud of. Yeah. So for the nude scene, Michael Caine went on a physical training regimen of 10 cigars and 3 bottles of scotch a day for 6 months.
That's dedication.
There you go. Yeah, he does have a little bit of a pot on him when we see the nude scene. But yeah, so this is a commentary channel, so we'll be watching the movie. What we'll do is we'll synchronize watching the movie together. We'll give you timestamps throughout. We'll talk about what's happening. We'll comment. We'll give our understanding and fun facts, trivia, our own inside knowledge about the movie itself and the people who act, the actors and the director, etc. And also as well, the parrots down in Australia will be joining us. They're on the show, but that's fine because we've had dogs, we've had cats, we've had everything on the show in the past, so it doesn't really matter. I've had my wife come in at points and say, why are you still up? Yeah. Get a job, you lazy bum. I do have a job, but you know, there you go. Anyway, so we're going to start the movie now. We're going to have this little countdown thing that we've got. So it'll count down 3, 2, 1, and then you'll see the arrows going everywhere. When you see that, you can press start on your copy of the movie. I've got mine ready to go. Mm-hmm. And I think the copy we've got is about 1 hour 50 around that time. Is that right? I think yep. So. Yeah.
Mine's 1:51:41, but
sorry, to be pretty precise, mine is 1:51:47. So you've got, okay. I've got 6 extra seconds.
Director's
I just don't know what to do with those extra seconds. We'll get started and we'll give you references throughout. I should have also mentioned as well that Matt has a comic book out right now called Kiri. If you're interested in comic books, especially historical adventures, then you should check out Matt's work. And Tony is just a really nice guy, but he's not doing anything right now other than just being awesome. But let's get on with the show.
It's a full-time job.
It is. It's a full-time job. Now behave yourself. Yeah. You're a big man, but you're out of shape.
and that is true.
And the other famous quote is, you couldn't win an egg and spoon race. And there's another line, but it's a bit more sort of like a bit more sweary, isn't it?
But, yeah, it's a lot sweary.
So I'm gonna. We've got this little video here. So when you see the 3, 2, 1, you see the arrows, then all you have to do is press play on your copy of the video, and it's so simple, even a boomer could do it. So let's go and let's do the countdown.
3, 2, 1.
There we go. And there's the Metro Gold Mayor Lion. Kitty! Oh, look what we've got in the chat. We've got Jake Duchesne and Matt sent me.
Welcome.
From the tweeters.
He's a good
welcome.
Guy.
And straight away we've got that fantastic soundtrack for the movie.
That is so good.
By Roy Budd. And I've seen the video for this, you know, and he just played it straight off the top of his head. Obviously, he knew the tune, but he was a jazz musician on 2 keyboards at the same time. Well, he had 3 keyboards, actually. He had a harpsichord and piano that he plays at the same time, and then another jazz organ. And he played it, as he played it and recorded the soundtrack, he was watching the action. So it's all perfectly timed with the way Kane moves his head and everything. It's so precise. So this is and you'll see straight away that Kane is detached here. His character of Jack Carter, he's a bad man, but he hasn't descended into like the moral degradation and degeneracy of these other guys here. And he's just not interested there, looking at pictures of, you know, like porn images. And there's the fantastic Britt Eklund. And he's just not interested, is he? So he goes over to get a whiskey.
It's amazing how cynical this movie already is. And how, like, you couldn't do this maybe 3 years. This is 71, right? And just how much culture swung at that point.
This is look at the stain on his face. It's just priceless.
Yeah. He really is. The message of this character is he's a hard man and he's a killer, but he has a moral code. And this is this is what runs in the tradition of film noir. He is a class in very much, he's very much a classic film noir anti-hero. So you want to sympathize with him, but you can't, but you still do to a certain extent because he has a moral code of his own. So
yeah, I suppose that fits into the vigilante genre as a whole. Let's hear what Elrod
says. They killed Alfie's dog and he became Jack Carter. Sorry, go ahead, Matt.
Well, it's just funny. Like, I've heard people comment on the popularity of vigilante films and how it seems to time with there's like a lull in the economy and maybe a lull in the culture where people kind of feel like, you know, what are we here for? And they want a hero that kind of breaks through the, maybe there's too much there's like a bureaucratic mess or there's a malaise or something. And they just kind of want an action guy who's going to, he's breaking the law, but he's doing it for something.
For the right reason. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. He doesn't have to adhere to the rigid rules. And here we get this fantastic scene and this whole sequence, it's 3 minutes long. This intro is one of the best intros of any movie I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. And it's literally just his journey north. And it's as if he's going back in time as well, because he's going back to the roots. Because he talks like a Cockney, but his character originally left Newcastle as a young kid. Like, you can imagine he left 12:30 and ran away from home. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, he's been living in London for like 25 years, picked up the accent. And but now he's on his way back, and so it's for him, it's like going back in time, and all of the things he does, like he's got the, you know, the stuff for his sinuses, he's possibly got some sort of stims there, you know, like pick me ups. And this whole sequence is incredible, and it just shows that he's a typical old school gangster. He's got class, he's got style, and but he is a hard man. And the book he was reading at the start there was Farewell My Lovely by Raymond Chandler, which obviously has the private detective Philip Marlowe in it. And you see Kane wearing a detective coat later on, so very much the first couple of thirds of the movie he comes across like a Philip Marlowe kind of character.
Just getting back to something Matt was talking about with vigilantes and that, I think also a lot of the that comes down to that need of an eye for an eye sort of, you know, for justice, more so than it being like for revenge or anything. It's more like that sort of sacrament of justice,
like a moral code.
Yeah, moral code. And that's why it's sort of popular.
Yeah.
And they do go through phases where they're not popular and then they come back again. So
yeah, it's when the system, people feel like the system's failing you, I guess, and that's when these sort of characters arise. Yeah,
absolutely.
And it's very much a tragic here as well. I mean, this essentially is a tragedy, this movie, the story. In the strict dramatic sense, it is very much a tragedy of events, but it's a moral tale, you know. It has a moral message to it.
Just thinking of this montage of him on the train reminds me of how what's his name? Edgar Wright did Hot Fuzz of him going from the city to the country, except he did it in like 3 seconds of jump cuts. Whereas this is like, no, you want to see the slowness of it. You want to see his, like the thoughts in his head and that as he's heading back home.
Go ahead.
No, I was just saying that it was an interesting thing, like that Edgar Wright did, where it's like, oh, I'm going to use like him on a train from here to here, like they didn't get Carter. But
yeah,
I think doing it like the way it's done in this is really deliberate. It's a long journey. He's got a lot to think about, and
he's sort of getting into the frame of mind.
Heads are going to roll.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's I don't know whether you noticed in the same carriage as him. Shouldn't really say this as a spoiler, but there's a guy sitting opposite him, right, who you're going to see later on, and he actually was holding a paper that was talking about gang wars.
Yeah.
Right, so, because there's a gang war going on. This is the Long Bar, which used to be the most famous bar in Newcastle, and it's interesting because this movie, one of the main things about this movie is it films Newcastle at a period of transition. So you see that guy looking away from there? He's not messing about. Nobody looks at him.
Oh, I love this.
This is that you see the old style of Newcastle where you had the granddads and grandmas having a pint. Yeah. And the point is that not only is it a city in transition, but the very year this film was filmed, 1971, was the same year this bar was actually demolished. This huge, amazing building, which was the, I believe, the Douglas Hotel. Yeah, the Douglas Hotel was, like, built in 1835, I think, and it was demolished that year and replaced with a eyesore of a, modern architecture, because at the time you had these, shall we say, progressive local city councils who demolished half of the city and these beautiful historical buildings. And it's widely regarded that the Long Bar was like the finest Victorian bar in the whole of the country. And it was called the Long Bar because the bar was like 70 foot long. So anyway, there's the famous scene of him on the phone, which you've seen in 1,000 GIFs. Now he's going back to the house of his dead brother. So he's going back to Frank's house. And it's no coincidence that his brother's called Frank, because this was filmed in a street which was, as the film was being made, was being demolished in Benwell. This is the poorest area of Newcastle at the time, and it was being demolished. And it was actually called Frank Street. So I wonder if that was the inspiration for the brother's name. So here he is going into the empty house, because there's nobody there now, apart from his brother, who's in a box. And yeah, so he's just checking out the house here. And oh, we've got Kuzmeti in the chat. Hey-o, Kuzmeti. Sorry, it's a bit late for you. Just to the point where Kane picks up some pink knickers off the floor, which, because his dead brother, Frank, had a girlfriend, which we'll meet later, called Margaret. And there is also a daughter in the movie as well, his brother's daughter, who's... obviously, he will meet later on. So...
It's neat to just even little moments like this. I can already tell a lot of this movie is going to be very different than what we see nowadays.
There's a lot of hidden signs you've got to watch for the stuff in the background because there's clues all the time. It's like as if it's a detective movie, in a sense. You're going to see stuff in the background all the time. So he's very careful the way he handles the shotgun there. He's got the shells. That was his brother's shotgun. Couldn't have this today in modern Britain. You would be arrested and put in prison.
Yeah, imagine a shotgun in your bedroom.
On the on the top of the wardrobe.
There's nothing better than just a single light bulb like that just hanging there. It just adds so much.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like the sparseness. And, you know.
And the water damage on the plaster on the walls and stuff.
Yeah, and that image of his hand on his brother's hands.
Mm. Yeah.
Because the character of Jack, he knows he's the black sheep of the family. He left. He knows he's the rotten one. But he still has a moral code, as we talked about earlier. But the rest of his family, he feels to blame, in a sense, for the rest of his family, because we're gonna find more about that later. But he has a deep affection for the rest of his family, and it's really broken his heart that his brother's died. And so this is the housekeeper. Edna, who is played by Rosemary Dunham, and you're going to start to hear the Geordie accent. Some of the actors are Geordies, some of them are from Yorkshire, and they can't really do a Geordie accent, but you'll hear two or three of them, like Alan Armstrong, he's a local lad. We are pretty far north, right?
For those of us who aren't as familiar. I mean, we're right up there, right? Towards Scotland.
Yeah, we are the last major English city before the Scottish border. But at the time, Newcastle was very important. And you're going to see scenes here. I mean, when I was watching this movie earlier today, just to remind myself, it's weird because some of the stuff has not changed at all. And some of it's changed radically. And one thing that has changed is there is no industry on the Tyne anymore. Huge ships used to come in the river, and it just doesn't happen now. So it's weird. This is the daughter. So this is his niece, Doreen, played by Petra Markham. It was actually also a Doctor Who on the Doctor Who show. She was one of the Doctor Who's assistants. Doreen is supposed to be only about 16 at this point. And we're going to find out more about Doreen and the connection between Doreen and Jack later on. And she is actually key to the whole... I'm spoiling it here, but she's in the background at this point, but she is actually key to the whole movie. She's the center of the whole story. But that's a classic example of film noir, where characters are subtly introduced. This in the background is the Dunstan Power Station. You're going to see it again later. I'm working at Woolworths.
She looks pretty familiar. I feel like.
Yeah, she's been in a few things. She was in Doctor Who back in the 70s, briefly. Everybody smokes in this movie, by the way.
Yeah. As you do.
And we've got. Jake says nobody gets named Edna anymore. They don't. This is very much like. It was a name that would have occurred in the 50s, wouldn't it? Because if she's 16, this movie's made in 71, so that's a 1955 name. So here they go, taking them off. You're going to see this beautiful scene. The director, Hodges, uses perspective beautifully. And there's a lot of scenes like this all the way through where there's a beautiful and deliberate use of perspective. And I think it's not only wonderful to look at, but it gives an idea of scale. So you see those terraced houses
going
on forever. And then in the background, in the mists, you've got the Dunstan Power Station. That's gone now. It's been replaced by our first out-of-city mall called the Metro Centre. And this street, it doesn't exist anymore. It's just flat.
Wow.
So Alan is speaking with his accent, which I try to hide. That's a northeast accent.
You could pull one of these out if you got a couple drinks in you, maybe.
I could do it now, but you wouldn't understand me much.
Yeah.
So here they're going. This is the biggest cemetery in the whole of Newcastle. This is the West Road Crem, or the West Road Crematorium. And it looks almost exactly the same now. But this is when I watched this movie, I thought, my goodness, this is the West Road Crem. The West Road is an ancient Roman road which goes along the wall, all the way along the wall into Newcastle. You know the Roman wall?
Hadrian's Wall.
Yeah. And I've actually been in this chapel for a funeral because it's, one of the biggest ones in the city. It's most people have been there at some point. So we have Michael Caine's character there of Jack, and beside him we've got Doreen, and then Margaret pops up in the background there, and she's trying to keep a low profile, but we know that something's up when she tries to get away quickly.
I tell you, it's neat to see this compared to Dirty Harry. Where it's same year, and the city is a character in both movies.
Yes.
And the depressing dreariness of both cities.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to see some fine architecture, but you're also going to see some really ugly, modern architecture, like the high-rise car park in Gateshead, which was preserved for many years with the only excuse of, hey, it was in Get Carter. It was eventually demolished because it was an eyesore. it just shows you the city's in transition. Mm. A lot of stuff was demolished on the outskirts, but then they also demolished beautiful buildings in the city centre. And it in most respects, this development was good in some places, but in the majority of places, the city did not really get any better for a long time. Newcastle as a city has always had its wealth taken out and moved. In Britain is a country where the southeast and London sucks the wealth out of the rest of the country. So I'm not being left wing here, but I'm certainly not a neocon. So this is again the Douglas Hotel, but the other, this is the Snug, and enjoying a nice half a pint there. Cheers, anyway.
Yeah.
This is where they're discussing whether he's committed suicide and what's happening, why. And look at the reactions from Doreen. She knows something that she's not talking about. She feels guilty for some reason. Michael Caine, when he talked about his reasons for making the movie, said, one of the reasons I wanted to make that picture was my background. In English movies, gangsters were either stupid or funny. I wanted to show that they're neither. Gangsters are not stupid. They're certainly not very funny. But he identified with Carter because his memory of working class upbringing, having friends and family members involved in crime, it represented part of his life. Because there's a lot of similarities between Newcastle and London. I've got relatives in London, and there's a lot of connections between Newcastle and London. They're very similar with the working class background of a lot of people. Having hard lives, having to work hard.
Yeah, and port cities, kind of working at the docks, I guess.
Both cities, major ports, you know, shipbuilding, all that kind of thing. So there's a lot of similarities between the two cities. You'll notice as well throughout that Kane's, we're talking about Kane's moral code. Have you noticed how he's always compensating people? He's always, because he's a, he wants to be a gentleman. He's always, get yourself another suit, get yourself that, you know?
Is it just me, or has Alan Armstrong not changed since in 50 years? Like, he's just got less hair.
Yeah.
But he looks, if you take a little bit of that hair off, he looks exactly the same in Patriot games. And he looks the same in New Tricks.
Yeah, he came out looking pockmarked and 50 from
it. It's like, but... I mean, he's a great actor. I'm not having a go at him for that, but he just looks the same.
Absolutely. This is Gosforth Racecourse. Now, I'm not kidding. This is one place that has not... This looks exactly the same 50 years on. Exactly the same. And he has the character of... well, this guy's really important to the story as well.
Oh, he'll be good.
This is... Yeah. I love the way he drops his hot dog out of his... As soon as he sees him, he runs...
there's my guy.
Yeah, there he is.
Michael has an awesome set of sideburns.
He does, doesn't he? And we're going to see that. This is the famous conversation between Jack Carter and Eric. Oh, there's a cat. Kitty.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. Like I was saying earlier, this channel is also a soundtrack channel.
we'll keep the birds away.
This interchange between these two characters, but they're both really good actors. They both hate each other intensely. And this is the standard thing of, hello there. That's the gangster metaphor of, it's not what you're saying, it's the way you're saying it.
Mm.
So these two hate each other and they want to kill each other, but they're being very polite. But yeah, the interchange is really good. So yeah, this is Eric, played by Ian Hendry, who's very important to the story. And his job is, he's currently chauffeuring, but... comes out, he says, never apologize for a kitty. Very true.
That's the neighbor's cat. Because Medi... He likes to come in every once in a while. He looks exactly like our cat.
Because they've got no loyalty. Cats have no loyalty at all. They'll just go wherever they're fed. Sorry, Cosmetti. Yeah. They've got no loyalty. So exactly. Anyway, so this is Michael Caine's character trying to grill him to find out who he's working for, if he knows anything about what happened. And this is a famous line, Tony.
Mm.
They're still the same. I'd almost forgotten what your eyes look like. They're still the same.
That's great.
Piss owls in the snow. That's probably the most famous line.
Piss holes in the snow. Oh my goodness.
Isn't it interesting thing, the way it's been filmed, is that nowadays they would not have the horses walking in front of the camera.
Yeah.
I think it's great because it makes it look like it's a real place.
Exactly. And the locations are fantastic. They've been all over the place. Yeah. They've really used as much as they can. The direction is great.
I've actually got to go now, man.
No worries, mate.
Sorry about that, but I have best of for the rest of the stream, and I'll chat to you later on.
No worries, mate. See you later.
Right. Bye.
Nice hanging with you.
Yeah, you too, Matt. Bye.
See you later, Tony.
See you, Tony. Cheers. Oh, they were all having a drink in the car.
Yeah. So these are other gangsters who were at the races, and now they're coming back to Kinnear's house. Kinnear is there's two major crime bosses in this movie in the Newcastle area. You've got Brumby and you've got Kinnear, and they're going to Kinnear's house. And this is the rule where these gangsters are trying to look respectable. So they've adopted, you know, they bought nice houses in the country, big cars and all sorts of things. And so they're just trying to pretend that they're gentlemen, you know. And Kane's character's gone there to investigate. So he's followed Eric, who's the chauffeur he's working as a chauffeur for Kinnear. And he's followed him there so he can sneak into Kinnear's house and question Kinnear. And he just picks up a branch on the floor and just uses that to whack out the guard. And then he's an expert at what he does, you see. So he's able he knows all the methods. What comes across in this movie is this guy is an expert at what he does. So
could you educate us a bit on, like, what does organized crime look like in England?
It's very different from America in regard to...
It's not the Godfather or something.
No, it's not. It's there's similarities, but I mean, have you seen any Guy Ritchie movies?
Yeah,
Snatch and Lock Stock. Yeah, it's just like that. It's people from the lowest background, working class backgrounds who... There's similarities, but it's
just kind of making just hustling...
Yeah, exactly. And they try to not get noticed as much. You know, it's more integrated with working class life. I've actually known gangsters in my life, and I can verify that movies like Snatch and Lockstock are actually accurate.
Yeah.
They are. Oh, that's what it's like.
Yeah. They got a bunch of pigs they can feed you to.
Yeah, go through bound like butter. So here he is. He's got into the room with Kinnear, and Kinnear's entertaining these three guys. Yeah, he's having a high stakes game with them. And on the right of Kane here is a very drunk. This is the Lush for Kinnear. This is Glenda. Mm. Played by Geraldine Moffat, and Glenda is Kinnear's bit of fluff, you would say. This is where you find out there's a connection between Kinnear and Jack's boss down in London.
Ooh.
And this starts the ball rolling on something for Jack, where his boss wants him to come back home and don't cause any trouble. Because the conversation at the start of the movie was basically his boss saying, you shouldn't really go up there, we don't want any trouble. And Jack, as we said earlier, has got his own code and wants to do what he wants to do, decided to go up there anyway. And now this, him barging into Kinnear's house starts everything rolling in a certain direction.
Oh, that's a big, yeah, okay. Yeah, as someone who hasn't seen this, I'm already thinking... What is his boss back in London
thinking of this exactly? Because he doesn't want because his boss doesn't want any trouble. So his boss is as much of a threat to him as anybody else is, you know. And this actor here who plays Kinnear, John Osborne, was actually a playwright, a poet, a writer, and a philosopher. he wrote loads of books, and a very, very intelligent man, and as well as that, a very good actor. So he plays Kinnear, and we're going to find out later on about what the hidden truths are about Kinnear. But this scene with Glenda is incredible, because she plays the drunk lush really well, you know, like,
oh, absolutely.
She's completely stewed, and she's you know, doing all the things that a woman would do with the, well, men are exactly the same in this regard, but you know, just she's coming on too strong, etc. But she's a fantastic character, because we meet her later on in the movie, and she has a very interesting sense of humor. But again, she's sort of emotionally dead, you know, she doesn't have any real morality at all, and all of these people have no regard for anybody else, you know.
Yeah, I'm feeling it. Yeah, very shark-like.
It is. Mm-hmm. Another thing about Kane, when he came to Newcastle and saw the poverty, because a lot of this was filmed in Benwell, which is still today one of the poorest areas of the city. He said he'd never seen poverty like it in his life. Even coming from where he came from in London, he still was shocked by it.
Mm.
Britt Ekland, that we saw earlier, she reappears halfway through the movie, was reluctant to do the movie as well, by the way. She didn't want to be typecast. She'd already done a couple of gangster movies before, played gangster molds. But she had some money problems, so she agreed to do the movie. But she was happy about it afterwards, because it turned out to be... it wasn't a massive success, but it turned out to be, you know, have a cult following.
Yeah, and I'm sure, just like in America, there was probably 10 years worth of gangster movies ahead of people, if they had the talent to get a job in it. So
absolutely. There's a lot of actors in this movie who were also in another movie, which we might end up doing. You might be familiar with Barry Lyndon.
Oh, wow.
We've got to do that movie sometime. But interestingly, not only is there a connection with... There's about five actors in this movie who were also in Barry Lyndon. Not only that, but this is actually one of Stanley Kubrick's favorite movies. So it says something if Stanley Kubrick likes a movie. It's very Kubrick-esque, isn't it? This is a scrapyard on the
shots. Yeah,
beautiful. That's the high bridge before on over there, which is the railway bridge. There's a railway track on the top, and there's a road underneath.
Mm-hmm.
So there's seven bridges across. Well, at this time there wouldn't have been, but you're going to see all the bridges across the town here. But in 1971, but this is a scrapyard that used to be on the banks of the Tyne, and he's finding out about the car, his brother's car, that it was he was drunk when the car went into the river,
and he's asking about the brakes.
This is it. As nothing wrong with the brakes.
Hmm.
We're back to the long bar again, with the club singer who isn't male, is female.
Have we seen that bartender before? He's
That's Alan Armstrong. That's okay, Alan Armstrong.
We've talked about him.
And this is the first movie role for Alan Armstrong.
Mm. That's great.
So, you know, he went out to do loads of other things. So
yeah, he's wonderful. Hmm.
And even though this is his first movie role, what a great actor he already was at that point. We're getting a reference out to Thorpe. So Thorpey is one of the people that he used to know when he was, you know, a youngster. And Thorpe is there to try and control Jack. You know, he's been employed by somebody to send him back to London.
Have we seen Thorpe yet? Was he at the
not just card yet? Game? He's going to appear in a minute. Okay. He's going to appear in a minute. But this behavior from the club singer is about to cause a riot, by the way. But Thorpe is played by Bernard Hepton. At the start of the movie here, we're just getting we're getting sort of hints of what's happened. We're not really finding out very much because everybody's trying to cover everything up. Because Matty says, I've had to find a copy of this, never seen it. I do have tea though, real British tea. I didn't think you liked tea, Kuzmeti. I've got if you just check the Discord, Kuzmeti, and I think I've been a bit remiss there. I should have put something in the Discord before there. Let's have a look. So this is Pink Street. Just in the background there is the Central Station, which is where he came from earlier. And here is Doreen. And this is where he wants to take her away to South America with him because he wants to protect her, because she's about all he's got left of his family.
Yeah, she's not completely, I suppose, she's innocent. Corrupted.
Yeah, she's the only thing left that he... Mm. We'll find out more later, but at this point, she's the only thing left that isn't corrupted. So he wants to try and help her out. And you see how affectionate he is with her, that, you know, he really wants to protect her. And
I like the money thing. That's him. He's like, you know, I went down to the city. I went down to London, and
yeah,
this is what I came back with. Like I went down for that money. It's almost like, I guess it's a symbol of his power, and he liked to help out where he's come from, I suppose.
This is it. He's trying to you know, do right by people. And he's like I say, he has his own moral code where he wants to try and do right by people. So here's Britt Eklund. And this is the famous phone sex scene. So here we're going to see the first Bristols. I mean, this
for
is
the phone. Reason. That's funny.
Yeah,
that's
this is the phone sex scene. And this is also a bit weird because he's talking to her while Edna, the house owner of the bed and breakfast, housekeeper, is listening. And she gets more and more vigorous with the way she's rocking her chair because...
So bizarre.
She's here. It's all very uncomfortable, this scene, because like she's listening to Michael Caine as Michael Caine's talking to Britt Eklund. And
how bizarre. Look at this.
It is so weird. So Kuzmeti, we've got about 39 minutes, Kuzmeti. So if you want to track up to 39 minutes, this is this is weird because you've got like this. In a way, you've got like a triangle because you've got him and her over the phone, and then in the foreground in the room where he is, you've got Edna, the housekeeper, and she's listening, and there's this real emptiness in her eyes, like, you know, she's been left on the shelf, and you know, she just doesn't know. You don't know what's happened in her life. She's, you know, it's just a very uncomfortable scene. But by the way,
so this is famous.
Yeah, this is famous. Yeah, yeah. This is also Britt Eklund is his boss's girl, and he's already been there. So this is the thing. You know, he's got a moral code, but he's just can't help himself, and he has a habit of doing this, and we're going to find out more about that later on as well. And then the boss comes in. What you up to? You got gut trouble or something? Just doing my exercises. Anyway, female friend on the phone. I'll see you tomorrow, female friend. Bye.
That's funny. It's funny that she'd do anything. I mean, it's not like it's not they're doing FaceTime.
No, but this is circa 1971, of course. And then he's looking at her, but then that'll be for me. But you've got immediately you're getting the idea that this is a man who's in control of everybody around him. He's not going to let anybody push him around. So it's very much in the tradition of Bogart. You know what I mean?
Sure, sure.
So
yeah, he had two women in control with one phone conversation.
Yep. It's crazy, isn't it? So this is Thorpe, who's arrived with a ticket and to tell Jack to leave town. Go back to London, Jack. And again, here you stay in the car and I'll talk to you from here. And this scene, by the way, the location of the guest house is actually Coburg Street in Gateshead, which is the south side of the river from Newcastle. You're going to see some amazing athletic ability here because people are able to jump 10 miles, 5 miles, 20 miles and not blink an eyelid. Because I don't want to spoil it for you, but the locations jump around. And I know because I'm from this place, but you know, to the casual observer, you would think these places are close to each other. Mm-hmm. There's the fight scene there with the, and there you go, it doesn't mess around. Oh, we've got Jeff Potts. Hello, Ledge. Hello, Jeff. How you doing, my lad?
Hey, welcome.
Jeff Potts has joined us in the chat, and we're glad to have you here, Jeff.
Yeah.
Which basically says, hello, Jeff.
Hope you got your copy up.
We're at 42 minutes. Got that there, yeah. So this is the what used to be called the galleries, which changed its name so many times. It's in the center of Newcastle. So both characters have just run like 4 miles in 2 seconds and across the river, but that never happened. Funny. This is all connected and all close to each other. That happens a few, especially at the end of the movie. They're like jump 40 miles at the end of the movie. But the direction's so good that you can't even see it. Jeff Potts says, hey, to Kazmeti. Kazmeti says, and I'm going to do a Michael Caine voice for Kazmeti as well. I'll shed it just like that.
there you go, lads.
It must be the tea. Yes. Nice cup of tea. Lovely. Nice cup of tea. Oh, Rosie Lee. Now, this is back in the day, Matt, where all the girls are dancing on the dance floor and there's no men. Okay.
Yeah.
Because if you were if you danced on the dance floor in 1971, you were a big Jesse. So you weren't allowed.
What's to a dance. Big Jesse? I'll assume say, I know what a big Jesse.
I'm not going to say it's an old-fashioned term for anyway. So yeah. There's the lads in the.
Well, they just hang out against the wall, I guess.
Yeah, they do, and they let the women dance with each other. Wow. Which was what it was like back in the day. Because Matty says smiley face.
Now what's the okay? So I had a friend in college who her mother was English. She was from the north, and there's a particular kind of dance that I guess gets popular at this time. Maybe it's a bit later, but like everyone starts dancing to like old R&B songs that they were getting from America, right? There's like this kind of.
I think that's probably, slightly earlier than this. It's probably the 60s. A lot of the pirate radio stuff in the 60s was like that.
It was like a big craze, right? Like everyone's dancing particular. Yeah,
definitely.
Maybe that's what we saw at the club.
Yeah. Could have been a bit of that as well. Like, this is actually the same year my parents got married as well, by the way.
Oh, fun.
So
50 years. Congratulations. Yeah,
but I'm not telling you, I was born some years after that, so you can't, you see, I'm not.
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Of course.
Jeff Potts says, my lord, do you have the share mark or down pat? You do have the share. Thank you very much. Oh, that's very nice of you, Mr. Potts.
Oh, I'm thinking of Northern Soul.
that kind of shuffle dancing. But
yeah, that's true. I mean, this influenced a lot of stuff from this, because a lot of political change in this era as well, you know, as the industries were starting to, there was a lot of corruption in both sides of the political aisle, which destroyed the heavy industry, coal mining, shipbuilding. So there's a lot of changes going on. And I think Our Friends Up North was one of the dramas that, if you ever get a chance, watch that. It's really good. Jeff says, skiffle dancing. Yeah, but we do have skiffle. I like a skiffle. there you go. He's just punched Thorpey. And he's wanting to know who's put Thorpey up to it.
Stop mucking about.
Stop mucking about. And this is a direct. I'm having memories of Maltese Falcon when I'm watching this. You know, there's definitely like a Bogart feel to it. Who paid you to shave me off? So he gets it out of him, and this is where he finds out about the gang war between Brumby and Kinnear. Now Thorpey says Brumby, which means that, you know, he's going to go, and this is where he goes off to Brumby's house at 2 a.m.
So Brumby and Kinnear, they're both, that's not a north and for South rivalry, right?
That's two rival gangs in the Northeast.
Okay.
Gotcha. Apparently there's two different soundtracks for this movie, Matt. There's a US, UK. At the start of the movie, Carter is with some Cockney gangsters watching a porn movie. That's the version we're used to here. And the voices are Cockney gangsters. Now, when it was redubbed for the US market, and the US distributor believed the accents would be too heavy for the American audience to understand. So you've got this constant thing going on where producers and marketers in America are constantly dumbing down the American audience. This constant low expectation thing going on, like, oh, the American audience won't understand this, that, and the other. And it's so patronizing. Because the American audience do understand accents. You understand me.
Oh, of course.
You know.
Yeah.
So it's just ridiculous. So, but anyway, there you go. I've never seen that dub. So this is the Nouveau Riche. This is his plush 1970s pad, which by today's standards looks like a really old council house. But
somebody it's
puking in the goldfish pond. So this is Brumby's house, and again you see how he's like a Kane's character is like a predator. He's stalking his prey. He's like in the shadows there, waiting to move in, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
And and there's a contrast here, which is pointed out by Kane's character later on. The contrast between Doreen, who was Frank's daughter, and Brumby's daughter. So Brumby obviously protects his own daughter, but at the same time, he's willing to do whatever to other people's daughters and things like that. So he has an inconsistent moral code.
Yeah, Kane's character's Carter is really really well balanced here.
It's a fantastic character, isn't it? And
he's very dark. He's a killer, and but he's but they contrast that really well with at least like he's the sort of guy who can clean things up. You know, in a way.
This is it, and this is what he's looking to do. He's trying to find. Currently, the studio, MGM, wanted Telly Savalas to play Cliff Brumby. I can't imagine Telly Savalas doing a Geordie accent. Who loves you, baby?
Yeah, he's a little too...
That wouldn't have... I can't imagine Savalas doing a Geordie accent. That would... He would never have been able to pull that off.
I mean, he's great for organized crime, but, yeah.
Yeah. Here's the famous scene, Matt. This is a famous scene. You're a big man, but you're out of shape. This is my full-time job, so behave yourself. Right. Brumby wants to punch him. Brumby wants to punch him because he realizes that it. Here we go. See the way he reacts when he gets touched. Watch this. Yeah. Does not. He's controlling himself. There you go.
He just steps back.
With me, it's a full-time job. Now behave yourself. Bang!
Oh, that's great.
I bitch slapped you all over the place.
It says goodnight to the missus.
That's it. Off he goes back to the bed and breakfast. But what's happened there is that, and I should give a time reference, we're at 51 and a half minutes now. And what's happened is Thorpey told him that Brumby was the one who sent him to send him home. So he's gone over to talk to Brumby, and it's obvious it wasn't Brumby. So it must be Kinnear who's trying to get rid of him. And now he's headed back to the B&B. And since he's been away, somebody's been there and attacked them. And the plot thickens, so to speak.
And at this point, just sending him away just means sending him back to London, right?
That's right. I mean, it gets worse than that because it becomes clear that it becomes clear to everybody that this isn't Carter is not going to conform. He's decided he can't take any more. He doesn't. He has a moral code where he doesn't feel he has any moral responsibility to be controlled or obey people who have no moral sense. You know, he believes he's above them, and he doesn't feel he should have to do what they say. Mm-hmm. And then he starts. He's had enough of them. Really, at this point in time, he's already had enough of the he wants to get. He's talking about going to South America. He's already made the decision. He wants to get out, and he just wants to leave this whole world behind him. He can't take it anymore, you know.
Yeah. It's about as far as you can get.
By the way, the shotgun that Carter has in the movie never gets fired at any time. The movie.
You wouldn't know that from the trailer. Wow.
So, it never gets fired throughout the entire movie. So there we go. He knows what she's like. I wish Ralph was here because Ralph loves kazoo bands. And this was the moment for Ralph because he loves the old kazoo. Back in the day, majorette kazoo bands were really big. And Ralph's a Gen Xer like me, and he's basically, he would have loved this bit.
That's real? That's so bizarre.
That's a real band. Yeah, he used to have majorette bands with kazoos. Jeff Potts, I think he's roughly the same age as me, so he might remember the old majorette bands. And literally all they're doing is like, they have like a reed in the top, and they just make it up. You just go, do-do-do-do. You don't have to play anything. You just sort of sing through the thing. Yeah. And that was a big thing in the 70s. You had loads of even when I was a kid, they still had them, and they would learn to twirl the baton and everything. There we go. Aisha 55. Jeff Potts. Kazoo. There we go. Kazoos are the best instrument ever. Anybody can learn to play the kazoo. The kazoos. Of a use. This is
youth and valor.
P-Law on the flag there is south of the Tyne River, which is a dead giveaway for the fact that they are in Gateshead. They are south of the river. Here is these fantastic actors here. They've been in loads of crime dramas. By the way, that's an Love old Jag. If Elrod was here, I would be salivating over that old Jag. Because when he says kazoo, yes, kazoo. And this scene here where they're actually in the middle of things when the other two turn up. Because it says Kazoo is a good K name for a rooster. Do you need breakfast? And he's busy in the middle when these two come through the door. And he's
how raw the, is this did, film? This is.
Did you
this,
have you noticed wow. the have you noticed the piss pot underneath?
Yeah, a little bit of a chamber pot. Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Under the bed. Don't let us interrupt anything. And that's Pete the Dutch and Con. Con played by George Sewell, who was in loads of crime stuff. He usually played policeman. And Pete the Dutch played by Tony Beckley. And they've been sent, so as you've seen it before, this is now escalating. They've been sent by his boss in London to bring him back before he does anything else. And they also sort of know now that he's been doing his boss's wife.
Yeah.
Or girlfriend. And he has the joke.
It's fun to, you can feel the Londoners are. It's nice to hear different accents like that.
Did he hear the joke as well? You know you won't use that. The Ganny means. So... yeah, and this is a bit where he comes out of doors with the shotgun naked. Yeah, so this is basically the idea that once you're in the mob, you don't really have any liberty of your own. You're controlled by other people. It's very much about everybody controls everybody else. You're in a straitjacket, really, when you're in the mob. So you have this freedom to do things normal people can't, but at the same time, you're highly controlled and regulated by everybody else. Yeah. Oh dear. Drop the pint of milk. Do you remember when milk used to be delivered to your door in bottles?
I experienced that in New Zealand for a bit when I was a kid. That was pretty neat, but never again.
And here's the majorettes performing there.
How funny.
Those double decker buses.
Wow.
They did a those great aren't job.
For the, just for the tourists up in that, I guess they were everywhere.
Oh, no, we still have double deckers everywhere, yeah. Nice. And that's a beautiful old Jag. Now, in the 70s, Matt, and you might be familiar with, I don't know whether you've seen Inspector Morse.
Oh, of course.
And he had that type of Jag, but it was beautifully kept. But,
It is the same, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. But back in the day, John Thor was also in another series with Waterman, a guy called Waterman, and that was a crime show called The Sweeney, and in that show they would regularly destroy those old Jags. All the time.
Oh, no.
So those cars would constantly get wrecked. It's a shame, really. Anyway, he's going to put them in the dunny, as the Australians say, or the outside toilet. Because these houses were being demolished at the time, but they still had outside toilets. You know, that's how poor the place was.
Is that a common council house type thing?
Back in the day, and all the washing hanging up in the back lane there, which he captures on his car. I mean, it's a brilliant scene, the way he walks out with the shotgun on him, distracts him, and then gets away. And he has loads of escape routes throughout the film. And then he's just taking the door off, which it might be a reference to Italian Job. I only want you to take the bloody doors off.
Yeah. So,
and then he just runs up and goes...
It's funny. I did see there may be other that might be a reference to Italian Job, because apparently they did reference Zulu earlier on. I don't know if you noticed. I thought it was a little weird. There was like a African shield on a wall at was it Kinnear's place? And I guess that's a reference to Zulu there. So.
Yeah, this is the thing. This is why Kubrick likes the movie.
Because
there's loads of visual clues all the way through it.
Yeah.
because the dialogue and the characters aren't giving anything away, but there's visual there's visual clues all over the place, and that's something that Kubrick did a lot. So here we get he finally catches up with Keith, who's been beaten up by Kinnear's mobsters from the previous scene. And this is where we get to find out a bit more information about Jack Carter, that he calls him a shit, saying that, you know, you even did your brother's wife. So there's a strong hint there that Doreen is not his niece. Doreen could actually be his daughter.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And that's what really clinches the story, right?
So yeah.
It all revolves around it. So there's three femme fatales in this movie, and then there's one innocent woman, one innocent girl. So the three femme fatales are Britt Eklund, and then you also get Margaret, who was his brother's bit on the side or whatever, and you know, his brother's girlfriend, so to speak, because you only saw him once a week. And then you also have Kinnear's girl, which is Glenda. So here he's talking to Margaret. And this is on, she says the Black Bridge, but this is the high-level bridge. There's currently seven bridges across the town. At the time, though, there was six bridges. There's seven now. But this is, all of the bridges were, everything on the town, all of these bridges were engineering firsts. So before the Sydney Harbour Bridge was built, the Tyne Bridge was built to test the design. So the Tyne Bridge is a smaller version of the Sydney Harbour Bridge, but it was the first one to be built. This as well was a test for things like the, is it the Brooklyn Bridge, which has railway and road on it? I'm not sure.
I believe so. Yeah.
This was a test for the whole thing of, you know, railway on the top, road on the bottom. So she's basically telling him a load of porky pies, saying that Frank committed suicide, and
takes the glasses off.
Yeah, then smashes them. And this is where he gets really hard with a really, really angry. Watch the brilliant the way he does it as well. And he just snaps on a sixpence. This crap owl. That's a great line.
Oh,
hey, and he's already angry when the Jag turns up, and then he realizes she's told them where to find him, because she is a really nasty piece of work. And we're going to find out what she did later on, which is really bad. So there you go, gives her a slap, not nice, but he's not a happy man. There's a Tyne Bridge in the background there.
It does have, I can see it's got the Sydney skyline feel to it.
Yep. And how fit was Michael Caine then? He just lops over there and runs around. You can see that beautiful curve on the bridge.
Yeah.
It's architecturally, it's really an amazing thing. So it is there. You see the railways on the top. So he runs across the bottom. So now he's on the, he's going down what you call the long stairs. These are still there. This is an old stair that goes all the way down to the Tyne River. And it's, as you can see, it's a long stair for a reason. And here's Glenda. That's the old town hall on the right there. They were on the Newcastle side now. This is the quay side. Mm-hmm. And we've got Glenda waiting there to take him away in her sunbeam.
Yeah, this is the lady on the phone, right?
Yeah. Well, no, this is another classy bird, which is Kinnear's girlfriend. So he's already been with his boss's girlfriend down in London, and he's just about to be with Kinnear's girlfriend. So you get this montage now.
Yeah. The The sloshed one. Yeah.
Yeah. She's doing quite a good Geordie accent there. I don't think she's originally from the Northeast. I'm not sure. So she takes him to the Demon King's castle, which is Brumby's project. Because in this movie, the high rise, this is the famous high rise eyesore, the high rise car park in Gateshead, which was there for many, many years. It was horrible. So she's taken up to meet Brumby, who was the other crime boss in the North that you've already seen. You know, you're a big man, but you're out of shape.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nasty.
Heading up the car park.
Run, Carter, run. So what I've got to say is really that Glendare is typical of a... I'm not being nasty when I say this, but... A lot of Geordie ladies are a little bit like this. They're quite attractive and they like to do what they want, and which is fair enough, you know. But that's if you go to Newcastle on a Friday night or Saturday night, pre-lockdown, I imagine, this is what you would see. A lot of ladies going out for a drink and... you know, it's a party city. Newcastle's a party city. It's always been a party city. So Brumby's explaining he's now trying to recruit, and this is interesting because you find out he's recruited somebody else before now. He's trying to recruit Jack to get rid of Kinnear. So again, he's just willing to use Jack to do his dirty work for him. And they're just all scum, really.
that's fun because, you know, a less well-written movie would have Carter would be getting closer to the center of danger, and it would just be people trying to kill him. But instead, you know,
It's like being a pilot of a plane. It's small adjustments. So the gangster thing is, it's like, it's defensive, aggressive, very slow moves, slight moves, you know, because you want to protect yourself. And whatever you do will have a consequence, which is why they're really scared of Jack, because he's a loose cannon now, you know?
Yeah.
He's upsetting the natural balance of everything, because it's like a negotiated nervous peace, you know.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, we got to someone's got to get them first on their own side, I suppose.
Yeah. So what ends up happening? All of the crime families, him and Kinnear and the people in London, they all really want to just sort of get rid of him because he's causing trouble. So. Do us a favor. I love it here when he says, stroll on.
Yeah, he's too dangerous for the whole system now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is another, this is it. Yeah. And the fact that he's trying to offer money to him, it's insulted his personal code as well. And it's a hint for him what's going on, really. The pieces are starting to fall into place now, because he's gauging everyone's character. He's very intelligent. He can figure out what everybody's motivation is, and he's filling the pieces in gradually. But you know, we're timestamp wise, we're coming up at 1 hour 10 minutes in about 15 seconds. This is the montage scene. Where you've got the car gear stick as a metaphor, an overlap with the this is the naughty scene. There's about three naughty scenes in this movie, and this is the naughty scene with Glenda. And it's like an overlap between this scene and the scene back at her place.
So that's interesting that they'd write it this way. So he's able to leave that meeting with. Kinnear and go straight home with Kinnear's girlfriend.
Yeah, so I mean, this is Kinnear's girlfriend, but she actually introduced him to Brumby.
Oh, sorry. So I'm getting him confused.
No, that's fine. There's a lot of the thing about this movie is there's a lot of characters. The first time I ever watched this movie, I had to rewatch it because there's a lot of characters. But it indicates that really, yes, they are separate, but they're all interconnected. So this is
nice of you to say. Yeah.
And the thing about the ambient noise in this movie is used effectively because you hear the wind in the background and you heard a lot of traffic noise before. So it indicates that she sort of lives outside of all of this in a sense. Yeah. This is like the scene where in a movie where you sort of pull yourself away from the central theater of what's going on. And you've got the sound of the wind in the background.
A bit of calm before more
bit
of
a calm,
storm,
and it's done deliberately because you're about to see this is we're reaching the fulcrum of the story now, where the moment of what's it called, denouement or something, the untying, where I'm using fancy terms there, where everything comes clear, everything they didn't see before and you couldn't get an answer for, he's just about to get everything revealed in one go. And then at that point onwards, it ceases to be like a investigation and noir type of movie and becomes just complete, I wouldn't say a revenge movie, but I suppose vengeance and moral indignation. And he goes out to punish everybody who's, I suppose, like a nemesis kind of thing, isn't it?
This is so interesting.
And it's what she doesn't say. It's between the lines. And you get to find out that she has no moral code of her own, really. She doesn't really care. And
there was something about that. That's why you waited for me.
Yeah. This is it. So here we go. He's going to see this movie, which is in this flat because Brumby comes across the city. She goes between Brumby and Kinnear, and now this movie is in the flat there for Brumby to watch because these crime bosses are into all sorts of horrible things, and you're going to see this film here where they all star in this movie, and this is the moment where Michael Caine's heart breaks, you know, because he sees this movie and he realizes,
there's his niece.
Because there is his niece, which is actually his daughter. The only person who was innocent in this entire world, the only person who was innocent, has been exposed to something, and he recognizes Glenda's in the film, Margaret's in the film, so they're both to blame. They were both involved in this. It's been filmed by Kinnear, but it's also been watched and enjoyed by Brumby, so they're all tainted, they're all poisoned, which is why he wants to get, and this links back to the first scene where they're watching a porn movie. So
yeah, it does. Yeah.
And so this is the most disgusting truth of the movie. Of course, Doreen would not have known what was happening in this movie. The contrast between this and the way Glenda is in the bath, just relaxing without any understanding of the fact that she's just about to be destroyed because of what she's done. So he didn't recognize her at first in the movie, but now he knows who it is and he's watching, and he doesn't want to watch, but he has to watch to find out what happened. And this is, it's interesting how he gets to find out as a voyeur, like an observer on a film. And this unlocks everything. This is why his brother died. Because his brother found this film, found out what they'd done to Doreen.
Oh, no.
Okay.
And
so you can see Doreen in the movie does not know what's going on. She's just not aware of what's happening. and she's a complete innocent. Mm-hmm. And in walks in the guy he's been trying to meet up with since the start of the story. He doesn't know he was involved in this, but now that's it, you know. Albert, played by Glenn Edwards. And here he starts crying because it's the last thing he thought was untouched by all of the horror that he's gone through of being in the gang world. Even that one person left over has gone through that horror.
Yeah. And it's now, too late even for her.
And this is the bit where he snaps completely. He just completely snaps altogether. And
amazing.
For him now, that's it. He's resolved to destroy them all.
Wow. No, this is a 50-year-old movie, and this is darker than anything I've seen in a decade.
Yeah, and I mean, you think about how this is probably the worst thing you can do.
Yeah.
And I remember watching this movie and being, like, shocked. It's very culturally relevant to the things that are happening today in society. Yes, cosmetic, indeed. And you see, he's still got the casual sort of, so about that movie, because he's just questioning her.
I love the shot.
Isn't it great? And that shows the contrast. She cares nothing. He still has a moral code. And he's questioning her about who set it up. Eric set it up, but he set it up because Margaret recruited her. Okay? Margaret was his dead brother's girlfriend, and because she was going to see Frank, she picked up, she was there in the house and picked up
Doreen.
Yeah, there we go, and he's drowning her under the bath. Is there a Discord for this? I'm not sure, Jeff. Do you mean like a Discord to discuss it, or we don't have like a community Discord, but we can set one up though. I could set one up for you, Jeff, if you want to do that one. I'll connect you with the best people. Now here the scene. Carter tells her the surname Carter, and you see the disgust in his face. Yeah, I can certainly set one up, Jeff. I'll set one up. I just haven't thought about doing it, but yeah, I will certainly set one up. Connect it to the show. I'll do that, and you will be the first invite. I promise.
Oh, there you go.
So there's she goes into the boot of the Sunbeam.
Yeah.
And then the Sunbeam's parked up. This is the ferry, the Shields ferry. And this is South Shields. And now he's gone back over the other side of the river to find Albert. Because there's two separate towns. You've got the city of Newcastle, and then you've got the town of Gateshead on the south bank.
Pretty little cathedral in the background there for a moment.
Yeah, there's a lot of Victorian churches still around today. That go back to like the 1830s.
Wow.
I mean, there's earlier stuff than that. I mean, Newcastle's existed for about 1600 years, roughly. But growing up with it, you just don't think anything of it, you know, because you just... Now, here's Albert, who was a gambling addict. Jeff says, don't go out of your way for it. No, I will though. I will go up your way, mate. Don't worry about it. You want a ledge. Because Matty says a movie watch Discord is a great idea. It is. Thanks, Jeff, for suggesting it. It just shows how dumb I've been not to set it up before now.
Be easy to do. Yeah.
Albert's this is great, this isn't it? Do you want to go to the toilet, Albert? I think you want to go to the toilet, don't you? Go to the toilet.
Oh, no.
Come on, lad. Go to the toilet.
I'm amazed how far... Oh, there you go.
He's running.
Carter does get away with a lot in this, but I guess it's because
he's just he's completely in control of yeah. everybody around him. You can't get away from me, Albert. Can you believe, well, like, there's only like 25 minutes of this movie left, roughly 25, 30 minutes
no. already.
How oh, fast
it's gonna
is it?
Be a killing spree.
Here soon. We go. So Albert has obviously, he's a, let's just say, he's a pedo, isn't he, really, Albert?
Yeah.
He's a total yeah. scumbag. And potentially Doreen is Jack's daughter. So do you think he's going to let him off? And Jack is a professional killer. Do you think there's any hope for
Well, he's the first
for Albert. Because yeah. Mike says, Carter is a stone-cold smith. He is, he's stone-cold. He's yeah. colder than a stone. He's even more cold than a stone. So, yeah. So there's the backstory, Matt.
There you go. He'd seen the film.
Brumby had Doreen. Seen the movie, right? Wanted to meet Doreen, indicating he's into it as well, unfortunately. And yeah. But then he realized he could get one up on Kinnear, didn't he?
Yeah.
So oh, wow. what he's finding is Eric, the guy who was the chauffeur, they forced the whiskey down his throat, got him drunk, put him in the car, and took him away. So they did that because Frank was going to spill the beans on all of this, because it's obviously highly illegal for a good reason.
It all ties together.
And wow. Eric hates Jack so much that he knew Frank was Jack's brother. And he said, good. Because Eric really hates Jack. And he wants him to know that.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah. So now we know the full truth. And you see how that is left till almost the very end of the movie. Which is yeah. a good idea. You were talking about movies before where, you know, you find out far too early everything. And so this is really violent, this scene. I didn't kill her. Oh, no, you didn't. Oh, no, you didn't. He stabs him God. As he says it. I mean, how? That is just like, what he's saying is, I know you didn't kill her, but because of what you did, that resulted in, obviously, you did this thing to my daughter. I'm going to kill yeah. you for that anyway. Secondly, what you did resulted in my brother's death.
Two so, stabs for that.
Hmm. Yeah, there's two stabs. One for doing what he did to the daughter. One for what he did resulting in his brother's death.
Hmm.
And this bloke here is in a gambling trance. Going to put two unlucky leak, please, Rita.
A gambling trance, I guess that's a thing, yeah.
Yeah, well, it is, it's addiction, isn't it? I mean, some people would say sure. it's a spirit, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's definitely darkness. So in one, you know, if you're addicted to it, so here they are, they've arrived, Eric, and Pete the Dutch and Con, and they're at this stage, as you said, you know, it's got to the extent now where they're just gonna wipe out Jack. That's it. He's had his chance. Now they're just gonna wipe him out. And
yeah, they've given him a pretty long leash. But you know,
yeah. So he's returning from Newcastle back to Gateshead, this on the to the south side of the river, on the Tyne Ferry. This still exists, the Tyne Ferry. When you want to go from one side to the other. You get a glimpse of the kind of character that Jack wants to be, because he sees the family life, the traditional life. And to some respect, the gangsters are not about that. They're about progress and moral degradation, because they make more money out of moral degradation. Whereas this is the traditional family unit. These little girls here are innocent, and he's looking at them and thinking, you know,
yeah,
this should be preserved. And he's thinking about Doreen, and
yeah,
there's a lot going through his mind at this point.
Yeah, who else could be caught up in this?
Well, everybody, the entire network is caught up on it.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently as well, Michael Caine said he came across the gangsters whose life this movie was based on. Highly critical of the movie, saying that there's no gangster in the world like Jack Carter. He didn't have a wife, children, or responsibility of any kind. So the role has been criticized as not being representative, because most gangsters do have wives or kids or whatever. But you know, I'm sure there's people like Jack out there.
Hmm.
The kid is about to break the fourth wall, Matt. The little kid.
I saw you there.
Yeah. Weeping.
Well done, kid. hey. See, never work with animals or children. So this is a great scene. The Mrs. Mack watched this movie with me earlier, and she said Pete the Dutch is the scariest character in the whole movie. Because he's just he just pulls that gun out of his coat and lets it loose straight away in one move, you know. And he looks scary because he looks so unusual. He looks like a typical, like, weird 70s gangster. And he likes to kill people. Yeah, silk scarf, blonde hair. Like sort of a punk kind of look.
Mm-hmm.
I love this, the way he's taunting them. And
love that accent. That's great.
Yeah, I mean, he's actually a Scottish actor, but he's doing a decent Geordie accent.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, he's doing a decent accent. Can you see these huge ships in the background? You don't get that now. Newcastle was
mesmerized by the size of that. It's,
well,
Newcastle. Never seen something that big.
That's it. All this stuff was on the Tyne. This was the major shipbuilding city in the whole of the country at one point. Mm. Yeah, so they've just admitted there that they've already told his boss in London that he's been, you know, he had the girlfriend. So he's finished. He can't go back to London. And this brilliant scene here. Look at that.
Oh, that's great.
Don't! So he actually pleads, don't do it. And the only reason he's saying stay where you are is so he's not a moving target. He's easier to shoot.
Yeah.
Now, when the first time I watched this, I thought I didn't think anything of it. And then I remembered Glenda's in the boot still.
She is, isn't she?
And
And
there she goes. Now that in a way is she's not directly responsible for Frank's death, but the poetry of the fact that she's now ended up drowned in a car like Frank did. And it's just the fact that, everybody connected to what happened to Doreen and Frank is getting wiped out. And here we have Brumby. And these two architects are brilliant because they're completely completely unaware of what's going on.
Yeah.
Who's that bloody madman? Extraordinary. Extraordinary.
Doing the cravat. Yeah.
They have silk cravats and everything. These people live in a different world and they just don't know.
So you said this building was new at the time, or
it was, yeah. Wow. And it was an eyesore for many years.
The big concrete.
This is the big finale, Matt, at the end, towards the end of the movie. This is what it was famous for. So he used Frank to get at Kinnear because Kinnear was moving in on him, so he used Frank to get at Kinnear.
Yeah.
And he didn't care that they ended up killing Frank. Mm-hmm. And this is where he compares Doreen to his daughter. Mm-hmm. And look at the way he's punching him. Look at the anger in his face. And he just, within three or four punches, he just wrecks him. So that's what he's saying. His daughter can get away with whatever she does. But the Doreens of the world just get used and abused.
That's powerful. You don't have to say a lot with that.
And there he goes. over the side. And that is the famous scene that this movie is known for, where he throws Brumby over the edge of the multi-story.
That was in the trailer, so I knew to anticipate that.
Yeah. Now, when he throws him to his death, Mike Hodges used four shots for that. One of the pair struggling up on the stairs, one for the lowest level, where he actually threw Brian Moseley, a stuntman, over the side onto a mattress. And then one shot of the dummy falling. Oh, where could he possibly be? This is great. And the other one comes up to him and says, I don't think we're going to get paid for this. Hang on, what's he actually saying? Then the cop has arrived, like something out of Monty Python. He comes over and says to him, I have an awful feeling we're not going to get our fee. There he is on the phone again. And he's going to meet somebody on the swing bridge. Swing bridge. This is a Geordie accent, these two women.
It's a nice accent. It really is.
That's why all the call centers in Britain are based in the Northeast, because it's a lilting accent. Everyone just goes zoom do 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 like that. It's very similar in sound to Scandinavian because of the Viking past.
Oh wow. Is that Vikings. Where it comes from?
Yeah, Vikings settled in the Northeast, so a lot of and then mixed with a bit of Scottish and but it produces this lilting accent, which sounds nice, but can sound incomprehensible depending on who's speaking. This is the swing bridge, Matt, and in the background, the beautiful shot of the time. This director's shots are unbelievable. The swing bridge was the first mechanical revolving bridge in the world.
And it
rotates through 90 degrees, so it lets ships past. So it can be a bridge from one side to the other, and then it turns 90 degrees, and then the ships can go past.
That's amazing. I'm in love with this city. This is great.
It's loads of history. Loads and loads of history. We're spoiled for history, really. Anyway, so he's picked up some drugs from some guy on the swing bridge, and now he's gone to track down Margaret, and she's at the bingo hall. I don't know if you know what bingo is. It's an English thing where
we have it here too.
It's
usually retirees playing it, but
I mean, everybody plays it now, apparently. It's like a housewife favorite now, so
neat. That's funny.
Anyway, so this is destroyed now as well, this building, but on the left you'll see a pub called the Strawberry, which is still there today. It's been there for about 150 years, I think. And opposite the on the other side of the road that you can't see is St. James's Park, which is the stadium for Newcastle United Football Club. This is one of the stairs that go down on the lower half of because Newcastle's on a 60 degree, well, about a 45, 50 degree incline. So you've got all of these stairs going all the way down to the river. And he's following Margaret. And you can see why Kubrick loves this movie. And reminiscent of the Third Man with the Third Man film noir shadows and use of darkness in the periphery and everything. And I've come for you, Margaret. Here we are, Kinnear's pad. With a selection of hangers-on, circa 1971, with ridiculously over made-up faces, which is, you know, the way people wore makeup in the 70s. And so in this scene, we talk about Carter having power over people. This is the point where Carter now has leverage over Kinnear, and he's doing it because he wants to kill Eric. So to kill Eric, he has to get Kania to allow him to kill Eric. So Kania gives him Eric. It's all very Machiavellian, this bit. You know, Machiavelli's the prince.
It makes sense.
You hairy-faced git. See, and that was what the other guy was trying to do, because the film obviously is underage stuff, isn't it? So it's like, it's, you know,
yeah,
it's going to result in him getting arrested.
Hola. So he's willing to go to the authorities. Interesting.
Yeah. Well, he's already posted the movie off, hasn't he? He's telling them he's got the movie, but that's already posted it off. He's making Kania believe that he's not going to do it, but he has actually already done it. He's posted the film off to the police already.
That's true.
So he's basically, what he's done is he's gone through all of them and he's killed the ones he can kill, and the ones he can't get to, he's done it so that the police are going to arrest them and put them away for a long time.
That's great. Yeah.
So he's got them all done up like a kipper. do you know the theme music was recorded on a budget of 450 quid, which is about in dollars, it's about $700. Not much, is it? But
just, then
it
was just kind of hiring local bands, I guess.
No, it was the composer was a jazz composer, but I think he just really wanted to do the soundtrack. This is really freaky, this bit. Because he takes her out to the back of Brumby's manor. This is his field and lake at the bottom of the house.
Yeah.
And this is to frame, sorry, not Brumby, Kania. This is to frame Kania. And this was a bit I found hardest to watch, because...
Wow, worse than this, the others.
At this point, he just does not care anymore. These people are you know, they are marked people, you know.
I'm surprised. I mean, the girls, they're very obedient for people who think that are pretty sure they're about to die.
Yeah,
but I guess
I think they're just trying to preserve their lives. She doesn't know what's going to happen next, though. She's not sure. She's a bit short of a pound, really. But but it's just so shocking the way that he does that. Does this?
And oh no!
He basically puts her down like an animal. Gives her an injection.
Yeah.
Which must be like an overdose of morphine or something, and that's it. Gone. Dead.
Yeah.
I mean, it's wrong what he's done. It's totally wrong, really. But the way he sees it is that she was the woman who, she was like the you know, I won't mention the words on this stream because those names will get us cancelled. But there was a certain famous female recruiter for a certain famous person who didn't commit suicide. So she like recruited Doreen. So she's responsible for what happened to Doreen.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he's done it that way. But, you know, I don't excuse what he's done, but at this point, that's it. So the only thing he has no control over is the fact that Kania is now going to employ this hitman to kill him. So he's employing a hitman to kill a hitman. Now, do you remember the first scene in this train carriage? There was a guy opposite him reading a paper.
I think he had that ring on his finger.
He was in the railway carriage, actual same box with Jack Carter on the way up from London. What does that tell you? He has been sent up there to, in case Jack goes rogue. So he's been following Jack the whole time.
Are you serious? Wow.
I can go back and show you. He is at the start of the movie. I didn't realize this. I watched it a couple of times recently.
He's the insurance on the whole
thing. He's the insurance policy. And if you go back to the start of the movie, he is sitting opposite Jack in the train compartment.
I do remember him because of your intro to this the YouTube stream.
Yeah. So that blew me away when I realized that. And that's why Kubrick likes this movie, because it's right in front of your face.
Of course. Yeah.
It's there, but it's hidden, so to speak.
Yeah. And you don't have to telegraph it. You just have to show his ring on his hand or something.
Exactly. You show not isn't beautiful. This is a beautiful even though there's a lot of explanation of events and lies and misleading facts and fiction, it's still a show not tell movie.
Yeah, this is great. It really gets better and better. Look at this.
And the other coppers have turned up. So he's dubbed him into the coppers, and you wouldn't normally do that in the mob, but he knows he's done for anyway. So he's doing is he's trying to destroy. He knows he's knackered, but he's trying to destroy all of them. And this is as many policemen that you normally see in a Monty Python sketch. Yeah. And so this is where we jump to a totally different location. This is, we're meant to believe this is still Newcastle, but this is actually in Blythe. And these are what you call the staithes. And that is like a massive wooden platform. It used to be three stories high back in the 70s, but it was destroyed by arsonists 20 years later. So it's only the bottom row. So he gets out, puts the bottle in there and the gun, because he's going to force Eric to drink. Like he did to, like Eric did to Frank.
Brother.
But the Blythe staithes are so high. Look how high they are. This is architecturally, this scene, how he uses perspective and he uses curves and out of sight lines. He's playing with the visuals all the time. Look at this. Beautiful. The side of the ship there and
so tall.
In the distance. Wow. Isn't it beautiful? And, the staithes in Blythe have a railway track on the top, which was for the railway to take the coal, and it was literally dumped straight into the ships you can see there and taken down to London. As in the phrase, like coals from Newcastle.
I love it.
Look at this scene there with that black line of policemen scouring for Margaret's belongings, you know? And of course, this is another thing they can pin on Kinnear. And if he gets murdered, he's going to go away for life. And you see how everything's black and stark, which indicates that, you know, because it starts where Kane is looking at his dead brother. And at the end of the movie, we know we're in, all the blackness and the fact that Margaret's dead. We know we're in a place where everybody's going to die, including Jack.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely.
He
knows how bad the city is now, and he's going to embody it.
Because Mike says, this is just brutal. It is brutal.
Yeah.
And I like the way that in the cold light of day, the gangster hangers on look like clowns with, you know what I mean? They look just like fools. You know, this is beautiful. This scene here where he's chasing them up the staithes, up the platform. And again, the use of distance and perspective and these things. I mean, this was a really long structure as well. You see the railway lines on the top there.
So all that's gone now.
All of that's gone.
Oh,
and
wooden.
Gonna,
wow. Look at
we're
going
to jump. We're going to jump 40 miles south in a minute to a place called Blackhall. You saw Blythe Power Station in the background there for a moment. That's gone now as well. We're going to jump 40 miles south to a place where they used to dump. There was so much coal, they had to dump it in the sea. And it sort of washed back up. The coal dust and made the beach black. This is a great line coming up, Matt. This is there. You go. You could win an egg and spoon race, Eric. You go out, mate. Stay away from the car. And says to take Margaret's body away.
Is it Chinatown or the French Connection where they're chasing each other up and down
French Connection.
Yeah, the Rays subway.
There's a lot of similarities. There's Blythe Power Station there. So we're still at Blythe. These are the dunes of Blythe. And we're going to suddenly transition to 40 miles south. Now we're 40 miles south at a place called Blackall. And this is where they used to do this. It's all gone now. £10 million was spent to clean this all up, right? Wow. And it looks lovely now. But this is one of the most amazing things you'll ever see. The architecture, it's like something from a dystopian future. These cages of leftover slag and coal dumped into the sea, and it just all washed back up, you see. So that's all like coke dust and coal dust.
Oh my goodness.
Washed back up onto the beach. And
wow.
And it's in the water. Can you see how black the water looks?
Yeah.
Because the water's, and there's an outflow pipe for sewage. This is 1971. This is, you know, there was no care for the environment at this point in time.
Well, like other 70s movies, they just, like if you did a city movie, you were seeing some of the worst.
And it gets to the point where you literally, it is real grime, you know? So it's unbelievable, the scene. Goodness. So he's chasing after Eric, and
I don't even know how you would clean up an entire shoreline.
Yeah, well, it did it. It did manage to do it, but it cost millions and millions of pounds. And this, again, you see the use of perspective, where on the we've got on the left quarter, between the third and the fourth quarter on the left, we've got the perspective line, and and now it's beautifully shot, and
I have a feeling I'm going to see where the coal got dumped, I guess, into the ocean.
And this is where hands him the whiskey. Go on, Eric. Go on.
Enjoy.
Have a drink, Eric. Go on. Have a drink. Drink up.
Keep going. Wow.
I want you to drink all of that. Do you understand? Drink it all.
Oh, no.
Just like it was for my brother Frank. And so he forces him to drink. So he's putting him through the same torment. I mean, it's just the grimy, gritty end to a grimy, gritty story, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
And this is the moment of full revelation, isn't it, where he confronts him with the truth. And if you go back to when he first met him again at the racetrack, you know.
Yeah.
And you don't even predict when he actually kills him, you know. Drink it, and then without you even realizing it. And then goodbye, Eric. Bang. When you least expect it. And he doesn't even shoot him. He just smacks him in with the butt of the rifle.
Yeah.
So that shotgun never gets shot in the entire movie. And then he's laughing. He's laughing at this point. But it's like a mad laughter because...
Yeah.
It's that point when everything's gone so wrong and you're laughing, but there's really nothing to laugh about. Because it's not going to bring his brother back. Look at that structure there with the big plaque on the front. And the cages go around. And then there's a mechanism that tilts them and they tip out. And the sort of half of it ends up at the top there. And then they go. Off he goes. Goodbye. Goodbye,
Eric.
Oh,
my goodness.
Goodbye, Eric.
Yeah, how dystopian can you get?
Beautiful shot, isn't it? And look at those structures. Like a concrete something. It looks like something by Magritte, doesn't it? It's weird.
Yeah.
Well, if Magritte was really dark. And watch this. He says, right, I'm finished. I'm going to go to South America. One last thing to do. Throw away the shotgun. Bang.
Oh, my goodness.
So just when you thought you could get out of it.
Yep.
He is then shot just when he thought he was out.
Wow.
By another hitman.
Of course.
And there's that soundtrack again. And
just cleaned up. Yeah.
And that's it. And as the waves come in, it's like it's washing him away, as if he's part of a past that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
And he's like the final person to die. And
wow.
And that's why it's a tragedy.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm seeing it's incredible. I'm seeing this is one of the best British movies of all time.
It really is. It really is. And
I can see that.
There you go. Ending credits.
Wow.
Overall thoughts then, Matt? What do you think overall?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna re-rent this and really comb through it.
Yeah,
this is another level. This is better than other. I'm trying to think. I saw a Michael Caine movie a couple weeks ago where he's in. Is it the Germ? It was like an East West German movie. That was okay. That was all right. But that really is some high art.
Jeff Potts says, "Go on the beaches. Don't let the people in Hollywood know that. Not a lot of people know that, Jeff." My name is Michael Pete McCain, and not a lot of people know that.
Like you said there, it is on another level. There is no other Kane movie like this.
Yeah, Funeral in Berlin was the movie I watched a while ago, and right. That was all right. And I guess that fits within his broader repertoire of I feel like he's done so many of these.
Yeah,
he just knocked them all out. But I think someone picked him up and took him. Just kind of set him on a throne.
It's incredible when you think as well that the same director directed Flash Gordon, completely different movie.
I can't. And, I can't handle that.
You know what I mean? It's just like this and Flash Gordon. What's going on? That's a first movie. This is the guy's first movie. Hodges, the director, who also screen wrote it as well.
That's incredible.
Cannot believe that. There's that much trivia, I really couldn't get through it. The overall effect for me is that this to me is like builds on the Italian Job, and this Italian Job is a beautiful movie. It's a fun movie, but it's more like the lovable rogue. This is like the other side of the coin to the Italian Job.
Absolutely.
You know, there's not even enough time to go into all the different connections with the actors and the different movies they've been in. You could do a whole show on just that. There's a lot of information on that, but the overall opinion of the movie is that it's become, you know, one of the movies to see before you die. It's become every year it gets more and more of a following. I think it's one of those movies which will never get dated because it does show a city in transition. It shows a time when things were changing. I don't think it was just Newcastle. I think the early 70s were a time of huge change everywhere, and it wasn't unique to Britain. And
yeah, sure, like Liverpool and a lot of
not only that, but in the States things were changing as well. You know, in the 70s, things were changing massively in certain cities. Definitely for me, it's always going to have a special place because it's interesting. Because when I'm watching movies, I'm watching cities in America a lot of the time, and I'm wondering, for Americans, you know, they're familiar with this or familiar with that. But this is even more enjoyable for me because this is a rare occasion where I'm watching a movie and I'm thinking, this is my hometown, and I know that place, and I know that place, and I know that place.
Yeah, and it's not just incidental. It's kind of a it's a love letter. It's a tragic love letter to your town, which is great.
Yeah, and the things that have gone, like the long bar, that was destroyed the very same year after this movie was finished. That building was demolished forever, never came back. So the last images of that bar, that famous bar, are in this movie. So it is a time capsule, definitely. I mean, overall, too much to go through. I mean, there's a huge list of trivia information here that I'm not going to bore anybody with, because there's some fantastic facts here. But overall, it was filmed in 40 days, by the way. That is interesting. How quick was that? Wow. By the way, you know the beach that we just saw there at the end?
Yeah.
With all the black sand on it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That was absolutely stolen. That footage was stolen and reused for Alien 3. You know the black waves? Yep, it was reused. The footage was reused. Because you know how all the coal in the water makes the water look black? And all the black sand and everything. That was reused for Alien 3. Can you believe it?
Oh, I'll have to rewatch.
They just ripped it completely and reused it. We've got Jabba the Creator. Says
Jabba. He's got a bit of an inside joke for me.
Fair enough. But yeah, so...
fantastic. Really, I mean, you always got the good movies to watch, but this is
No worries.
I mean, yeah, best British gangster movie. One of the best gangster movies.
Yeah. So sure. Very quickly, the last minute, I'm just going to quickly tie up on the last minute here. Box office was standard. Very respectable was the terminology used, but it's since then become a cult classic. The legacy of the movie is that almost every British filmmaker has had to watch this movie at some point and stolen the ideas from it. The Long Good Friday, Lock, Stock, Two Smoking Barrels, we talked about earlier. The film's resurgence in the 90s was phenomenal. A lot of bands like the Human League, Portishead wrote songs based on it. Been a massive inspiration for a lot of people. We could go on and on and on about that. It's in the top 100 of all British films altogether, but overall, a fantastic movie. And Jabba says you can't stop them, Matt.
Jabba. But stop trying to make ducks happen.
But yeah, I mean, phenomenal movie, which was so important and has become more and more and more well known. And incredible film, incredible direction, filmography, incredible acting. And to me, it's the archetypal British gangster anti-hero movie. So incredible. And thank you to everybody who's joined us today on the show. Thank you for Tony who joined, and of course, Matt. And thank you to everybody who joined in the chat. We had Elrod in the chat, Cosmetti in the chat, Jeff Potts in the chat, and quite a selection this time, actually, Jake, and also, of course, Jabba. And thank you to everybody who's going to tune in and watch recorded as well. This has been one of the most enjoyable movie watch lives that we've done yet. And to be honest, I could quite happily go and watch this movie again right now. But I can't because it's 4 in the morning here and I'm really tired. Because Matty has happy smiley face. I'm glad you enjoyed it. And it's been a fantastic experience. And thank you again, Matt. And thank you, Cosmetti, and everybody else who came in the chat, Jeff, everybody else, and Jabba. And we'll do it again next time. But until then, thank you, everybody, and a very good night. Good night.
Good night.